Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 56. So we're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT NoGov license.
Yes, as always, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT No Government license. This allows for reuse by anyone except governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
Is Michael Dean going to mail me a BIPCOT sticker for my... I guess ANCAP crowbar here.
You got to pay for yours, Dave.
All right, never mind.
I don't even think we have stickers. I haven't gotten any stickers. There's buttons. I can get you a button.
Then I'm going to have to like duct tape it on there or something. That ain't going to work.
So today we have Michael Lindskog, who is a leave me alone-ist, and we will please ask him to elaborate on why he hates labels. Because he made his own up. But anyway, he's. You're the founder of FreeAid.com?
No.
Nope. Or you're just like you contribute
right now? Yeah, we're all just volunteers. I guess I have a title. It is the lead medical and charitable coordinator.
Okay.
Simply because, as a volunteer, when I came into the organization, I took it upon myself to just really push the organization, reach out to event organizers. Mm-hmm. Set up volunteers, just getting down to the nitty gritty.
Getting people involved.
Yeah, exactly. Helping people out. That's the way we at FreeAid operate. People who come in, they can exert as much of an effort as they want, essentially.
Yeah. All right. So just to let people know, that's FreeAid, FR338AID.com. And you can find them on Facebook. Same thing, Free FR338 on Facebook and Twitter. And so they've got what's going on, a wig campaign, which I'm going to let him explain that. So we're going to talk about the history of how he came to Liberty and then how he came to the FreeAid.com and what he's got going on there. So Michael, thanks a lot for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, I read the little blog post that talks about, what's the name, Paul Frontier?
Paul Frontiero. Yeah.
Frontiero, right.
Yep.
And, he was the reason that that website was started, the whole website, or just the week?
No, he was, for me personally, his passing came at a certain time in my life where I was in my young 20s, and he was in his late 20s. And we worked together in the medical field, as EMTs in Boston, Massachusetts. And he sacrificed his life saving two women that lived beneath him in an apartment complex, Nashua, New Hampshire. It's all detailed. It's over 4 years later. And as an EMT, I had to work with a kind of a cold demeanor just to kind of get things done and to be cool, calm, and collected in crazy situations. And it hasn't been until recently that I really kind of gained emotions back in a way, where I'm the kind of,
you're not dead to the,
well,
I guess other people.
Yeah. I was really able to keep that, I guess the mask, I was able to wear it well.
Dehumanizing.
Not dehumanizing, because I definitely had compassion for all these patients, but I was able to make it like a business thing where I was just there doing my job, and I tried not to get personal, because then when you get personal, it that's when it becomes difficult when, you know, bad things happen to people.
Sure.
If bad things happen to people that you really care about, it's more difficult than if it's just a John or Jane Doe.
Well, sure. I wouldn't say it's dehumanizing, Dave. It's more like compartmentalizing. And I've had friends who have been EMTs too, and there is from their explanation to me, there is a level of desensitization that you kind of have to go through. Otherwise you'll go insane.
Right.
Just like what you're explaining, like if you can't shut that off to some extent,
I think that's kind of what I meant by dehumanizing. Maybe dehumanizing the situation.
No, look
at this. Like, hey, look, I'm just doing my job here. This is, you know, a patient, you know?
Yeah. So yeah, this was back in 2011. And around that time I had just started becoming a constitutionalist. I did kind of go by a label in a way. It was Michael Badnarik that turned me on to the Constitution. He had an 8-hour YouTube series that just kind of really flipped a switch that just kind of, it changed my whole paradigm. So I started delving into that. Constitutionalism led to more edgy libertarianism, and then after a while, it just logical progressions, anarchism, owning ourselves, self-governing, just the likes. That continued to progress even further to an ANCAP status in a way, and then trying to, now I'm just, I've used the term leave me alonist. I got that from Ernie Hancock on Declare Your Independence on LRN. I think that just, that fits me the best in a way that essentially you do your thing. I'm going to be over here doing my thing and leave me alone.
My brother subscribes to the kind of the same thing. He calls it staying in your own lane.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. He's like, you stay in your lane, I'll stay in my lane. We'll all be all right.
Most people on a base level really agree with that. It's mm-hmm. I don't know why that people think once it becomes a collective thing that rights can be granted to higher power to tax and commit war and all types of other horrible things that the state oughts to do.
It is amazing.
Well, it's conditioning. It's years and years and years of conditioning.
Yeah.
And what's sad is when people, when you talk like that about individualism and individual rights and owning yourself, you know, people think that you're like, oh, you're so selfish. You're so egotistical. You're just thinking about yourself. What about everyone else? You don't care about other people. You don't care about your friends and your family. And it's like, what? So I shouldn't, you know, regard myself highly. Like, I should sacrifice myself for the collective. And I mean, what? There's no way that you can attend to your own needs for, you know, it's like, it's ridiculous logic. You
know? Right. Right. So yeah, where I was based geographically and getting into a liberty mindset, I was able to meet up with individuals in New Hampshire that associated with the Free State Project and Free Keene and a few of those liberty groups up there. So I was actually able to meet people and talk to other, for the first time, aside from books and podcasts and YouTube videos at the time, being able to talk to other liberty-minded people face-to-face really was able, it was hugely influential in my development in my own ideas.
It's refreshing when you don't feel alone in an ideology.
Right.
Or a philosophy or a similar line of thinking. It's like, is no one else looking at like this, looking at it like this as well? Like I'm the only one? No. I understand what you're saying. It's nice having friends and people to talk to and kind of shore up stuff in your head.
Definitely, yeah. So it's good to know we're not alone out there. And so once I got into that liberty community, I had left. So the incident with Paul happened in the end of 2011. I left EMS a month, shortly thereafter, a few months thereafter, just because the burnout rate on people that work EMS is really high. They say it's about 3 years, and I made it just past that, like four and a half years, and I was ready. I'm out. The pay's too low. The work is crazy. It can be crazy. Sometimes it could just be we're playing glorified taxi drivers. But sometimes we really do utilize the skills.
Yeah, I can understand that. I mean, I worked at an animal hospital for a few years, and I did the overnight, so we were an emergency hospital. So it's the same premise. Some nights there's nothing going on, and you're just kind of hanging out and, you know, just watching over things. And then other things happen, and other nights happen, it's insane. And yeah, but I can imagine, like you said, I mean, to try to desensitize yourself is one thing, but to put up with it, I mean, the burnout rate makes sense. I mean, how long can any one person put up with that type of stuff? I'd imagine anybody who lasts far beyond that has to become really hardened on some level to continue to put up with that. That's I don't know if I can handle that, honestly.
Yeah, it's working with people is, I mean, it takes a certain personality type, I guess. So I left formal EMS, and I still have these skills, and I wanted to help people, and now I'm in this new community in the Liberty community, and a friend of mine, Pete Ayer, co-founder of copblock.org, tipped me off about free aid. He said, there's this group of people, they're medically leaning folks, and they get together at these Liberty events, you should reach out to them. So I went to freeaid.com, I went to the contact tab, sent him an email, said, I essentially just said, I'm a former EMT, and I'm in the Liberty community now, and I'd like to help out. I got a response back from Teresa Warmke, the co-founder of Free Aid. And we took it from there. And essentially, I started, the first thing I did with Free Aid was I reached out to folks at Bardo Farm in Croydon, New Hampshire for Bardo Farm Fest. I told them that I would be teaching a simple first aid class. We had a few people turn out for it, and it was pretty good. So yeah, that was the first event that I was at with Free Aid. And since then, I've been at just about every event that we've been to, which has been about two dozen events now over the course of 5 years. We've been able to help countless people, and we do, so I guess our radio ad pitch, right, is Free Aid is a charitable mutual aid organization that dedicates itself to supporting liberty-loving, medically skilled individuals. Free Aid teaches health and wellness as well as CPR AED training through their Free Hearts program. We're trying to fulfill this Paul Frontiero Memorial Wig Campaign now. It's our latest campaign. It's our second campaign. Our first campaign was in 2013. There was a typhoon that devastated the Philippines, and we were able to raise $14,000, the equivalent of $14,000 at the time worth of Bitcoin. We were able to then get that.
That's awesome.
Yeah, we got that over to people in the Philippines on the ground. We got food, water, tools, all medical supplies. We really made a huge impact in 2013, showing, and it's the most proud thing that I've been part of Free Aid with, because it's just a shining star for me, because we helped a lot of people with Bitcoin and the internet, and it's just, back then, my understanding of Bitcoin was still slim. So with the naysayers out there, us being able to do something truly good with the cryptocurrency, people often associated it with, the dark net or various black markets, Silk Road, right?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
That was our part in showing how you can do good things. It's a currency. It's neither good nor bad. It's just a tool that we can utilize.
Sure.
And we saved a good chunk of change by transferring wealth internationally. You know what I mean? Instead of through Western Union, where the fees would have been astronomical.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure. If you're able to. I remember when Bitcoin first started up. That was the problem. The idea of it being able to be transported all over the world was there already, but the actual capability of it wasn't, because people in other countries had not set it up. But the typhoon? I forgot.
2013.
So by then, their people were starting to spread. So yeah, once you have that capability that people can receive it on the other end, then absolutely, you're you're in business. But that's really great.
It is amazing. But digital currency buys stuff and helps people. That's just amazing.
Well, yeah, but the one thing you said, the thing you said though, is really, I think, really important, that it was an example of what can be done, where most people were either hadn't heard of it or were down on it. You know, we got to do these type of, this is what we talk about all the time about, you know, just spreading the ideas and trying to make the state obsolete. Well, how do you do that? You provide other avenues. You show people how you can do what they, especially stuff like this, what they assume the government is supposed to do. Because look what happens every time there is a disaster. There's people are up in arms expecting the government to send half the people are up in arms expecting the government to send, you know, demanding the government send money to help them. The other half are ticked off saying that that has nothing to do with us. Don't send them the money. But everybody recognizes that it's the government doing it. So It's like it's not even another option. Like, yeah, charities here, charities there. But those charities that people go through that are supposedly private still have to go through the government regulations. They have to get their permission slips and their 501c3s, right, which means there's certain things, obviously, certain regulations they have to follow, which means there's certain things they wouldn't be able to do. Like Bitcoin, for example, I'm sure there's no way any one of those charities could actually try to do anything in Bitcoin without going through the government and asking if it was okay first. And here you guys were able to be on the spot right away. Okay, here's the money we can raise. We can get it there in minutes, whatever. I mean, what the transfer time is nothing, but the actual when it's approved can take a little while, but still, it shot over right away. And like you said, instead of doing it west,
it was not a matter. It didn't take a matter of weeks for the funds to get there, and then that turned into real thing, tangible items that people can use. It was there
minutes,
instantaneous,
just about. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's quickly. What I'm saying.
Yeah, that's what the reality of Bitcoin is. Is like banks either have to adapt to be able to match that to the consumer, or cryptocurrencies are going to put the banks out of business.
Just a hyper interconnected world, and it's just the times we live in, and so it's a new tool that comes with the territory of this digital landscape that we're now all a part of.
Sure.
Yeah, it's just the next step in the evolution of money. I'm always telling my kids, the difference between currency and money, because I think it's important to distinguish that, because I tell them, this is just piece of paper with ink on it. That's it.
Right.
It's not money. It's currency. I specify with gold and silver, silver coins. That's money, right? That has intrinsic value. It's not determined by any fiat or edict, right? And Bitcoin is essentially the same thing, but digital, right? It's the value comes from people participating in it and using it, right? And setting up their businesses around it. So, yeah, really awesome. What are you doing?
Yeah. Now, the one thing I did want to ask, though, because I you had mentioned this the last time we spoke, but I didn't really delve too much into it. Because you said you guys accept like donations in any form, right? But you only use Bitcoin. So that means you only, like, when you pay for things, you only pay in Bitcoin. Is that how that works?
Or do you try to? Yeah. If a volunteer brings in medical supplies or something, we'll reimburse them the price of the equipment or the supplies in Bitcoin. If we're setting up like certain travel arrangements or in as many instances as we can, we are utilizing it.
Okay. Mm. Yeah. Okay. So that's, yeah, but it,
we don't have a huge operational cost. Our store of value is in our volunteers, essentially. It's really not in Bitcoin.
No, I get that. I was just curious about, because you had mentioned that, and I was just trying to figure out how exactly that worked.
But
you have a dedicated group of people that are doing the work, and if they're volunteers, well, they're not getting paid. So yeah, there can't be too much overhead. But that's also got to be extremely convenient. That's another wonderful thing about this day and age. You don't need to have a storefront for something like this.
Yeah,
you guys don't even have to be all in the same area, as long as you can get to one another when you're actually going to events and stuff, right? Like, you could operate for the most part completely separately of one another, I would assume.
Yep, we do encourage volunteers to go individually if they're comfortable with it to these particular events, or there's always strength in numbers, especially when you're talking about medical coverage of any sort. But we have almost 100 volunteers across 13 states, 3 countries, and 2 continents.
Wow.
So yeah, it's
a lot.
It's a small group, but it's a core dedicated group of people that really believe in our mission of helping each other advance a voluntary society.
Sure. Well, yeah, and again, this is, you know, this is how quote unquote we do it. This is how you show people, okay, you think nobody will want to help one another in a free society? Well, no, here you go. Here's people who don't have to be doing this, are living in the current society and trying to show you that, no, this can be done right now. So if it could be done right now, why couldn't it be done in the future with less hurdles in the way and more people being given the opportunity? Because that's the one thing that, you know, all those charities out there and stuff, the ones, you know, the government-approved ones that get that have to follow the rules, and, you know, there's been enough of them that have been found out to be doing less than noble things with the money that they get, shall we say, over the years. You know, they're always getting caught up whenever they do those rankings. When people actually investigate it, they show that, like, how much of the money actually goes to the people. I mean, it's still not on the government level where, like, you know, what is it, every, like, 7 cents that the government takes in actually goes to the poor people they're supposed to be helping. I don't think it's that bad, but that happens enough. But there, amongst those groups, there's still good people that volunteer for them that just want to help.
Absolutely.
But I would think that they might be hesitant to jump ship, as it were, and work for an organization such as yours for the same reason that the people that run these organizations are leery about just getting rid of their 501c3 and saying, well, no, we're just going to do this anyway. You know, that I guess that's all got to be another hurdle, because you really, at the present moment, I'm guessing you could only really pull from the liberty movement, I guess. I mean, you could probably pull from outside too, but I guess it would be a harder sell to some people who are so conditioned to think that it has to be government approved or it's not. It's just some scam.
Right. Well, yeah, a lot of the events, or all the events we do, are either liberty or Bitcoin events. Mm-hmm. As of now, I personally have been trying to reach out to non-liberty groups to disguise myself, essentially, just to reach out and try and plant seeds, you know what I mean? That's what it's all about, is planting seeds of liberty in the minds of people. And then, you know, if they bear fruit, I don't know. We can only hope.
Yeah. Planting seeds of liberty podcasting. No.
Precisely.
That's what we do around here.
So the way I look at that, which is awesome, it's like death by a thousand cuts, because, you know, like Jeremy said, the way that we, you know, achieve a voluntary society is by making the state obsolete, right? Not by resisting the state or by attacking politicians or by, you know, like the way Larkin was it, the problem is not in Washington, D.C., right? The problem is in the people's minds and the way they think about authority, right, and hallucinating that they have power over other people. And so you're challenging, you know, the government-approved charities and welfare state, let's say, and then, like, other people, like unschoolers, are challenging the government, you know, government schooling. Then you have, you know, Dale Brown from the Detroit Threat Management challenging the police and the law enforcement. And so all right. These different people challenging different areas of government monopolies. That's how you do it. That's how you bring, you know, the end of this belief in authority of statism, right? You show people that this is the way it's done. And you're doing it. It's awesome.
We'll do it more efficiently. We'll do it with more compassion. We'll do it overall better, and it's just it really is up to us to create these alternative institutions that people have been conditioned to believe that the state has a monopoly on, mm-hmm. whether it's banking, medical care, media, it's every aspect,
mm-hmm. Everything they can get their grubby paws on.
Then they really have, the tentacles are on in everything. It's insane. I saw a headline for an article the other day that there was a Bitcoin detective investigation unit within the NSA or something like that. So I don't know.
Well, yeah. They had to hurry up and learn about it, because a couple of their own were stealing it, weren't they? Wasn't that what ended up happening in the Silk Road trial? The people that were supposed to be setting up Ross, two of them were actually pilfering the bitcoins, and I don't think they're
two FBI agents.
Well, I think it was one FBI and somebody else. Did the DEA get involved somewhere? It wasn't two FBI. It was one FBI and another one from another organization. But yeah, that was the thing. You know, at first when Bitcoin came out, even the banks didn't know what to do, until some people started noticing that some of the banks started dealing in it, or at least the people who own the bank started dealing in it. And then you realize, okay, yeah. Well, they know, so now we definitely have to get in on it, and the government too.
It's like, Bitcoin's illegal, it's immoral, it's wrong. Wait, how do I set up my Bitcoin wallet?
Well, like anything else, it's just about control, because we have to deal with that here in New York. You know, we're one of the states that came up with everybody's come up with these stupid laws about it. And
Bit license.
Yeah, exactly. It's insane. Like, I went from being able to deal with my little Bitcoin wallet, which I don't have that much in, but whenever I would use it, with no issues, and then all of a sudden one day I go to make a transaction and now I have to fill out all this extra information, and I'm like, really, for what purpose? Why is it really? Well, obviously we know why, because they need to track everything I'm doing, because they want to know where my money is at all times. Which that alone, that the fact that that Orwellian-esque control and focus on your wealth, that doesn't click with more people is just beyond me. I try to give status the break some more times than Dave will, but that one kind of just baffles my mind. Like, how do you not see that? they need to know where your money is, how much you have.
Well, they're like, what are you talking about, Jeremy? I can go outside, I can go to the store, I can get groceries, I can go to the amusement park. What are you talking about? I'm free. Okay, I can do whatever I want to do.
Yeah, the ants in the ant farm are also free, right?
I can drive anywhere I want. What's wrong with you, Jeremy? Come on. Stop focusing on the negative, all right?
Yeah, well, if the negative...
Do whatever you want, as long as it's exactly what I say.
If the negative wasn't affecting me so severely, maybe I would leave it alone. Unfortunately, the negative is usually the things that I just want to do that wouldn't be hurting anybody else, but for some reason I have to either jump through hoops or have to worry about being have a run-in with one of the with one of New York's finest, and I try to avoid that at all costs.
No sarcasm, right?
No, not at all.
the title of Joel Saladin, the farmer from like a biodynamic farmer out west. He wrote a book. He wrote a book, and the title of his book is "Everything I Want to Do Is Illegal." I think that encapsulates it pretty well.
Well, it's true.
He's a fellow that wants to just he's a leave me aloneist as well. He's just out there trying to do his farming, and he just wants to be left alone. Just let the man do what he wants to do. He's farming.
He just wants.
It's doing something that he's been doing for
decades. He needs more money to pay people off. Duh.
Well, yeah, but he just wants to grow his food.
He doesn't have enough money to pay off the gang, man.
Because raw Amish dairy farmers are more of a threat to society than, soldiers and politicians, right?
Right.
And they necessitate an armed federal FBI raid, right? Where's your cheese? Where's your milk? Guns drawn. It's like amazing.
We've determined you're a threat to society.
Exactly. Guns drawn. That is so ridiculous.
Can you imagine
cheese.
That?
Yeah, the dairy farmer's going to just have just a gang of mother frigs in there with automatic weapons, just waiting for the feds to come in there and stop them from making food.
You really think there's cheese in that refrigerator? Think again, buddy.
If I was a dairy farmer in this day and age, I'd probably have a line. I'd probably have a gun rack set up for the inevitable day that they would show up. But yeah, I get what you're saying, Dave. Normally, these people are not a threat of any kind. So why would they be prepared? But that's just intimidation. That's what they, in those situations, that's all it ever is.
Well, yeah, but it's like the government's rolling up on a heroin farm or something. I mean, geez, Louise.
Well, they have,
no, there's well, just dairy farm.
Just like the IRS has to do that when they roll out their big guns, because they have their own SWAT team. So when they do their raids, they have to justify.
Well, if you don't use your budget, you're gonna lose.
Well,
it.
Exactly. That's what I was saying. They have to justify the fact that they have these people in place to begin with. And how do you do that other than using them? Because, I mean, the average person probably wouldn't notice, but there's enough people out there, even in the status world, that pay very close attention to budget issues and what's being spent where, even on a local level. Actually, I would say even more significantly on a local level, especially around here, there's a couple of crazy conservatives that I've known for a long time that are very aware of what goes on with those things. So people would notice, So you have to make use of these things, because why, the fact that the IRS, I mean, now we're getting a little off topic, but the fact that the IRS has a SWAT team in general is just absolutely insane.
No, they don't have a SWAT team. They have multiple SWAT
teams. Okay.
The IRS, the IRS I can understand. The USPS and the Bureau of Land Management have SWAT teams. Well, that's for mail? Are you serious?
Well, no, but even if you're
Department of Education as well.
If you're trying to think in this, if you're trying to think in the statist mindset, the BLM actually makes sense out of all of them because that's protecting what they believe to be their property. So that actually kind of makes warped sense. But the IRS, you know, like there was, who was it? They went after the, it wasn't Gibson, was it? No, it was one of the other guitar makers. They went after a few years back. And they, you know, they did multiple raids.
Oh, it was Gibson.
Was it Gibson?
It was Gibson. Okay. Yeah, they stole their mahogany.
Yeah, it was all over. Yeah, it was a specific type of wood that they supposedly had that had been labeled endangered, I guess, or whatever. Like the
insect.
And they went after him, and they raided him multiple times. That was actually, I mean, that was a few years back now, but that was actually what started. That was one of the things that I found out early on that I was like, whoa. Okay, something's really not right here because the IRS should not have a SWAT team. And they do stuff like that. And so but these other organizations, I mean, who sends them after the dairy farmers? What is it, the FDA? They have their own SWAT too? I mean, come on. I mean, they obviously work with local police.
Most of the time it'll be probably a local commissioner.
Yeah, it'll be the bureaucrats, and they'll have the local police, which is even worse because those are the people that, again, the average person thinks, oh, well, they're not like the politicians. They're separate. The police, they're I mean, they
That's Jim. I know him.
Exactly. They're not going to think that. But now you got some federal or state or whatever it is bureaucrat coming in and just barking orders, and your buddy that you go drinking with on Friday nights is now pointing a gun at your other friends and going, okay, everybody on the floor. It's like, what the heck happened here? But that stuff happens. The fact that it happens at all, the fact that it happened more than once is bad. The fact that it's happened more than that is unconscionable.
Well, what happens is that, like, the feds claim, you know, there's too much corruption at the local level, so we have to have these federal, you know, enforcement wings of our agencies, and that's their justification. Oh, those won't be corrupt, but you know.
And then who's watching the watches, right? So they get corrupt, and you need a global enforcer, right?
Oh, when the global
enforcers get corrupt, then we need a solar enforcer, solar system. We need to just keep enlarging it.
We need the Guardians of the Galaxy. That's it. They'll take care of everything.
That's it. No one will be corrupted.
There comes a point in people, especially like authorities' lives, where someone might come across them and say, hey, your money or your life. And from that point forward, they're dirty. I mean, if politics already isn't a dirty game enough, but you know what I'm saying? The ones who get in there with a conscience.
Right.
Well, the ones that get in there with a conscience usually are not long for the job, because they either get very fed up very quickly and leave, or they try too hard to change things, and then the establishment, even on the local level, the establishment will get together and make sure that the next election they're out. Or the ones with the good conscience that stick around almost always end up just being swallowed up by the system and just become another one of the cogs, and they lose whatever. You know, I mean, one of the greatest examples is the a-hole who I have now lived under, because no matter, I've moved twice, and he's realigned his district both times so that I'm still in it. Peter King, I used to affectionately call him a Congress critter. Now I just call him a piece of shit. But that guy, I mean, he's been in there since the mid '80s, I want to say, and I know the local conservative groups. I know the heads of these groups because on my way to anarchism, I stopped in the Tea Party briefly and then headed to libertarianism. So I got to meet some of these people, and I became friendly with them, and I stayed friends with them. But I heard some stories from them because they were the type of people I were talking about earlier that are constantly watching. They still think there's some magic way we can get back to the Constitution and everything will be fine. But they keep a very close eye on what goes on. In, like, they know everything, all the budget stuff, everything. But they worked with Peter King, and they helped him get elected the first time around. And they have told me stories about this ideologue who was so fed up with the corruption that he saw, and he was going there to make a difference. And for the first 4 or 5 years or so, he was real, you know, he stuck to his guns and he kept most of his campaign promises, or at least whatever he could. And when he didn't, he came back home and explained it to everybody what went wrong and why he tried and he got outvoted. And he tried to, like, he even went so far as try to explain how the system worked to these people, like tried to, like, really, really trying. And then slowly but surely, he just started drifting and drifting and drifting. And then, then he got handed the keys to Homeland Security for a while. And he had my friend actually has lived next door to him for I think her entire life, or not next door, like two or three houses down, but on the same block and in very close proximity. And she would tell me stories. She would send me pictures of him with the security detail, like Secret Service, like President level Secret Service type people with the decked out SUVs and all that stuff, just hanging around his house at all times of day. Like the amount of money that was getting stolen and then pretty much given directly to Peter King was insane. But that's what happens, and it happens over and over and over again, because most of those guys, most of the politicians, like, you see that people, even the statists will complain about, like the 20-30 year guys that have been there forever, most of them started out with good intentions, and look what happened.
But Jeremy, you got to think outside the box, you know, like Bernie Sanders or like Donald Trump, you know,
think outside the box.
Bernie Sanders, who's been a politician since the early 70s.
Career politicians.
That's all.
The guy, I had an argument with somebody recently who convinced me that Bernie had worked in the private sector significantly. I'm like, he became the mayor of Burlington, Vermont in what, the early 70s, I think? That was his first gig. And he pretty much just, like, I think he took a couple year break after that trying to get other positions and other seats and couldn't. But he was still working, like, with the different political groups, and that's pretty much all he was doing. And he did side jobs to make a little money. So they talk about him being a teacher. And this one woman tried to tell me, well, he was a teacher. I'm like, he worked for Head Start. It's a government program. The guy has literally been a government employee almost his entire life. He has had his entire life subsidized by either the taxpayers or directly through handouts and kickbacks or whatever. And I don't care how great they say Bernie is and how he doesn't take the stuff. They all do. Anybody who stays there that long, they have to. It's impossible not to, with the exception of maybe Ron Paul. But that's also evident in what happened to him. You know, nobody would ever vote on any of his bills.
He was a career politician too, though, right?
Which is why he did
have his OBG practice, but no, aside from that, exactly, he's a career politician.
I don't subscribe to the great man theory of Ron Paul that a lot of people in the Liberty movement do. I
did in 2008.
I didn't find out about him until after, because I came late to the game. I didn't start coming to this fully until after the 2012 election. So I still, you know, I had barely heard about him. But still, he was a politician. He took the money. But I, like I said, I don't think he played. I think it's evident that he really didn't play the game, because nobody helped him out with anything. And that's how it works over there. If you want to get your bill passed, you have to help out on this bill over here. And when you don't, you can see that what happens when your bills come up.
Nobody it's one big cesspool.
Exactly.
I think it was Robert Higgs. He said, most statists, you know, it's a pool of feces, and most statists just try to find the cleanest area of the pool with the least amount of feces. And anarchists just want to leave the pool. We want to get out of the pool.
Precisely.
we're looked at as crazy, because instead of trying
we're
to
just
move,
sick of the sick of the shit, you know.
Instead of trying to find the clean spot, we're just like,
I'm
hey,
up
hey,
to here with your shit.
you idiots are looking for the clear spot. I'm like, hey, dude, there's a ladder over here. You see that? I'm going that way.
You crazy utopian. No, so it's funny is when I'm talking to statists and you can criticize Obama, you can criticize Bush, you know, Obama didn't close Guantanamo Bay. All right. He's pretty bad. Obama, increased the drone strikes. All right. That's pretty bad. You know, Obama, You know, did a, you know, George Bush did the bailouts. All right, it's pretty bad. So maybe we shouldn't have presidents. Now you're an extremist.
Yeah.
We just need the right person.
Well, none of those, you know, Obama and Bush didn't do anything. They're just the puppets, man.
Right.
They're the people that we're supposed to buy and sell as our leader.
If you're one step ahead of society, you're a genius. But if you're anything more than that, you're insane. You're on the fringe. You're an extremist.
Well, I'm definitely.
And exactly. Owning yourself is a few steps beyond what most people have been conditioned to think, which is a shame. I guess I could segue back into creating the things we want to see in a society that would be more free. Then with this wig campaign, this might be the first Bitcoin fundraising campaign for a wig type of thing. I mean, it's all types of, everyone's got their, the first Bitcoin X, Y, and Z thing, but I don't know. This might be the first Bitcoin fundraised wig campaign.
Most likely, yeah. I've never heard of anything such.
But yeah, I mean, to summarize, I appreciate you guys having us on the show, and this is an important thing to me, and we're trying to fulfill this campaign. So anyone that is listening to the podcast online, we're looking for a recipient, and we're going to fundraise the wig cost. I will cut off my hair. I've been in touch with the wig maker already. I'm going to have to get in touch with them again because it was when we initially launched the campaign 9 months ago. But the wig maker talks to the recipient, and they figure out the specific type of wig that the individual wants. And we're going to deliver the wig and hopefully talk to this person. If they happen to be liberty-leaning, we can talk about whatever. It's a way for me to memorialize a friend of mine who was just super inspirational, who essentially was a martyr in my life to do good, and just do good till the end.
That's awesome, man. I'm glad you're on a journey for peace and doing good things, man.
Yeah. Now, maybe we should explain the whole wig thing a little bit, because I talked to you previously, and you said that it was you were having difficulty finding a donor because there's channels that people normally go through for this type of thing, correct?
Right.
And people going back to that conversation we just had about the regulations and people being scared off by that, that's been one of your issues, correct? That you have. You've been having problems contacting a donor, which to me, like I said last night, seems completely crazy because you got to imagine there's people out there that can't afford stuff and are like, hey, somebody wants to give me one? Okay.
Right. So, yeah, 9 months ago we launched a campaign. We were actually at Porkfest when we launched it. Porkfest is a freedom festival that takes place in New Hampshire every year with the Free State Project. And I recommend that to people. We free aid. Do the first aid for that event. We have been doing it. This will be our fifth year in a row now. It's a great spot that if you out there listening haven't been able to, if you have similar ideas and you're just listening to podcasts all the time, it's a great place to go meet up for the first time with like-minded individuals and just really explore your own thoughts and concepts. But with this wig campaign, we at Free Aid are looking for a single individual who finds himself in a medical hardship who could use a wig. We've come across some individuals who could have used it, but they weren't necessarily looking for a wig at the time.
Does anyone need a beard wig?
I don't know if they do that. We're doing this. It's like a one-off thing. We're not trying to become like a wig organization to do it all the time. After doing this one, it's been enough of a project.
You got to get
this one done.
You got to regenerate the source, you know.
Right. Exactly.
give it time.
Precisely.
So how many of you are actually growing your hair out to do this?
Oh, it's just me.
Just you are the wig campaign.
I'm sorry.
He's the donor. No. He's
yeah. Ready.
He's
the here donor. We go. Bam.
Just you.
Long ponytail.
This is a one-man wig campaign.
So
right.
So you're trying to find a donor, and
instead of me going through one of these mainstream organizations, sometimes they charge their patients for their wigs. So I thought we could use Free Aid as a vehicle to try and find a recipient, fundraise, and then just do everything without the permission of the state, without the permission of these mainstream institutions, trying to do it, bolster Free Aid's resume, and just, you know, helping people help people.
Sure.
So, yes, if you out there on the inner tubes know an individual in need, and I guess this will be aired
Monday,
early 2016, since it's been so long of a campaign, I'm saying generalizing in seasons. But yeah, it'd be great if you could reach out to us at freeaid.com. We have a contact us tab. Just drop us a line. We'll be back in touch. And for us to complete this campaign would bring us some warm fuzzies. That's what we get paid in.
So how many possibilities do you have? Do you have any possible donors or recipients? Sorry.
So it's been 9 months now, and I personally have been in touch. I've been asking everyone, whether it's people on the street, because I feel like with this type of campaign, it doesn't necessarily have to be in like the Liberty community. So I've gone to church events and asked people there. And I get a lot of support. Everyone's very willing to help. People share it on social media. They share the articles that are written up. But yeah, it just hasn't come to pass yet that we haven't found anyone. So I'm thinking, you know, further reach through media outlets, and you guys are generous enough to have us on and, you know, share our message. Hopefully this will be the catalyst to get someone hooked
getting
up.
Get your haircut.
Precisely.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, the whole reason I wanted to have you on is because I was hoping that we could get this out to more people, because the one thing you just said quickly there, that was another thing that really bugged me when I heard about this whole story, was the fact that I wasn't aware that in a lot of these situations, people have to pay for these wigs that are these other organizations take donations, and then they take the hair donations. Right. And they still charge the people for the wig. Like, that's, to me, that just seems insane. Like, if somebody is going to you for a wig,
is that like a legality or a regulation?
I'm not 100% on why
they
do it.
Probably just so somebody can make some money.
More likely than not. But that's another reason I like your organization, because you guys are trying to do without that. And, you know, like you said, you're the only one doing it right now, and that's not the goal necessarily for Free Aid. This is kind of just a project you're doing along the way, just another fundraiser type thing, and just trying to help one individual. But I actually think this could be a prototype. You know, hopefully it will inspire other people. Hopefully we can help you, or at least someone along the line can help you find a donor, a recipient that is that's a good fit, you know, all around, and everybody will be happy. But I also kind of hope that other people are inspired to pick up this mantle, as it were. You know, if that's not a direction you guys want to go in as a focus, which I can understand, because your focus is more on the medical side, where you're trying to help people in that capacity, which is great, because that's another thing that doesn't, you know, normally if you go to events and stuff, if there's people there, they're being paid to be there. And if it's, you know, certain situations, it's usually county employees, so they're getting extorted money to hang out there and be at festivals and stuff like that. But in other situations, people are getting paid, and because of regulations, the prices are higher than they should be. But I kind of hope that other people would be inspired to maybe hear the fact that, oh, these poor people have to pay for these wigs, and here's a model that's already, again, assuming, proven to work on a small scale. Well, wow, maybe we can do this and get more people involved, and more people who would donate their hair to, say, what is it, Locks of Love or any of these other places. I'm not saying that they're the bad ones, because I don't know. But just that there's a bunch of them. But instead of going to those ones, maybe they'll try starting their own, and more people will do that. And that's just another way. So I that's why I love stories like this on so many levels, because aside from the good you're trying to do with this specific project and the good you're trying to do with the organization as a whole, doing little things like this along the way can also just be stepping stones for other people, which just gets the message out there faster. More people can take it and run with it. And more people showing others that the state is not necessary, which is just a beautiful, beautiful thing for me.
Yeah, I've definitely taken inspiration from a lot of these folks, that whether it's from the medical community or the liberty community, but I don't know, they've driven me to be a better person and to try and create these alternatives that are not funded through coercive means. And if I can help motivate people to do other things along those lines, then even better, that'd be great.
All right, so I know we're going to wrap up soon, but the one question I did want to ask you is, you had mentioned that you go to these different festivals, and so far it's been mainly Liberty ones and stuff like that, and that you've also tried to contact other organizations to ask if they want your assistance. But can people contact you guys and ask you to come to their events on their own, or do you seek them out only?
Absolutely, no. It's a two-way road. People definitely reach out to us through the website. We have an events page, as well as a contact us tab. That's the best way for people to get directly in touch with us. That would just be an email that shoots over to my inbox through the website at freeaid.com. If people are interested in having us at their event, I encourage people to go to the website, read the articles. We have a lot of health and wellness articles, some basic summaries of our goings on at events, as well as a few other things.
So I think we're about ready to close out. So Danilo, you want to wrap us up, or?
Yeah. I just say one thing this kind of reminds me, like when I was practicing acupuncture in a car accident clinic, and I would have some patients that would, obviously have a weave or a wig, or kind of related. And I think sometimes it's like taboo to ask women, is that a wig? But I'm just crazy. I just ask questions, and most people don't get offended with my questions. So I'm like, is that real hair or is that a fake hair? And they tell me, they're pretty honest. Like, no, this is not fake. I only get real human hair, which is pretty cool. And I'm like, wow, so we're usually from India. Yeah, usually from India. So I saw that document. I don't know if you saw a documentary, Chris Rock. I think it's called Good Hair. Did you see that?
I have not seen that, no.
About the whole wig industry.
No. Okay.
And wig and weave industry about how massive it is and one thing he was saying in the documentary was kind of funny, was that he was kind of trying to illustrate that black people cannot sell their hair. Like, nobody wants black people's hair. They only want white people's hair or Indian people's hair. And there was even one part in the documentary where he was like, he was on the street. He's like, I got black people's hair, nappy hair. Anybody want nappy hair? Nobody came. And then he went inside to the place where they were selling wigs. And the Indian guy was like, no, we don't sell those kind of hair. Look at the magazine. Only nice people. Are you serious? You don't sell black people's hair? So, sorry about that. Kind of reminds me.
That's ridiculous.
It's a good documentary. It's pretty funny. But Michael, yeah, thanks a lot for coming on the show, sharing your story. Really appreciate it. It's really cool. Never heard of this before. Jeremy let me know. So I'm excited to tell people that there is now a private wig campaign, completely privately funded, Bitcoin funded. The first one of its kind.
But I guess for like cancer patients or something, and maybe somebody who needs a wig like that, have you tried a children's hospital or anything like that?
So yeah, in the Boston area, there are a lot of large hospitals, and I did reach out to them. The reason they told me that they couldn't help us out was because of a Health Insurance Privacy Act, which is another government mandate.
Damn,
which does have some good purposes, because and individuals, because I mean, I don't think you fellows are opposed to privacy, and especially with your medical records, you definitely want to keep that. You only want you and people you trust to see that information. It could be done through alternative means. Sure. As far as privacy of medical records goes, and they I suppose they could have helped us out if they wanted to, but
I'm trying to imagine like a little 10-year-old kid with your hair, though. would you chop it up into two kids' hair,
right? If it could be two wigs, that'd be great.
Yeah, see. But you definitely
thanks for coming on, man.
I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks a lot for awesome conversation. And please, when you do finally cut it off, you know, record and make a YouTube video. You know, that's a momentous occasion. So
yeah, that's got to be content for the site right there. But
definitely right there.
Yeah, I mean, I hope you guys obviously are finally able to find a recipient. But again, I hope more people just check out your organization as a whole, because I think what you guys are doing overall is great. And I definitely, if I finally get my butt out of New York, I get a little further north, I'll make use of your services. Because awesome. we're gonna do a Seas of Liberty Festival one of these days. I don't know when, I don't know where, but we're gonna do it.
There you go. FR33AID.com. Yes. Events tab. Contact us. We'll link up. Have a good time.
Excellent.
Nice. Awesome. So if anybody wants to help our show out, you can do so through Bitcoin or Patreon, patreon.com/Seas of Liberty, to help us out. $1 a show is good enough for us. If you enjoy our content, please donate. We get very encouraged by monetary compensation. And if you find value in what you see, please donate value for value. That's the true anarcho-capitalist way, right? True democracy, voting with your dollar. So, or you can just like, comment, share videos, and subscribe to the show to help spread the message of voluntarism, liberty, and wigs for this episode. So awesome conversation, gentlemen. Thank you very much. So this is the Seeds of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care.
Peace. Bye.